All right. Okay. Welcome everyone to the DDPS seminar. Before we introduce our invited speaker, as usual, let's go over some rules and logistics. First of all, please mute yourself during the talk unless you have questions. If you do have questions, you are welcome to unmute and ask. Otherwise, please use chat room to post your questions so that we can address them in Q&A session at the end. Second, today's DDPS seminar is open to external audiences, so no classified discussion is allowed, so please watch out. Finally, the talk today will be recorded and uploaded in our YouTube channel. All right, let me introduce our speaker today. It is an honor to host Benjamin Sanders, who is leading the scientific computing group at CWI, the Dutch National Institute for Math and Computer Science. With his group, he develops new methods and algorithms that focus on hybrid models, which combine physical modeling and data-driven techniques. He works at the intersection of many different disciplines, including uncertainty quantification, PDEs and discretization methods, computational fluid dynamics, machine learning, reduced order modeling, and Bayesian inference. Main ongoing theme in his work is to leverage physical structure, such as invariance and conservation laws, in designing new algorithms. Okay. Sanders obtained his PhD degree in 2013, cum laude, from Eindhoven University of Technology, after which he worked as a researcher for a few years in industry, Shell. After completing a tenure track at CWI in 2021, he became research group leader in 2022, which is his current position. Today, Benjamin will talk about structure preserving learning of embedded discrete closure models. Very interesting topic. So please enjoy. Now, without further ado, let me ask a random question before I pass the baton to Benjamin. The question is, what is your favorite thing to do during the weekend? So Benjamin, you're supposed to answer this question before you start the talk.
Is it always the same question?
Yeah, it's not random anymore.
All right, okay. Yeah, my favorite thing to do is go out and do sports like racing bike or running. But currently with two little kids, it has changed a lot into hanging around the playground, which is also a lot of fun. But,
I totally agree. I totally understand. I have a four kids. So.
Oh, yeah, four, right. Okay.
All right. The stage is yours.
Okay. Well, thanks a lot. Thanks for the invitation. It's a pleasure to speak here for this audience. So, well, the introduction, I think, already says it all. So I'm not going to repeat that. I do want to acknowledge some of the people in my group, PhD students. Siever, Toby, Hendrik, and Hugo, who did a lot of the work that I will present today. And I also want to start with giving a bit of an introduction into CWI, just a few slides. Maybe not everyone knows the Institute. And then what I hope for this presentation is that that at the end, you will have a good idea about the title of the slide, right? So there are three elements. One is structure preserving, the other one is embedded, and then there's discrete closure model. So I try to highlight these three parts during this presentation. But first, let's talk about. Let's see if it get this working. I think I'm annotation. Okay, like this about CWI. So that's indeed the Dutch Institute for Math and Computer Science. So we are independent in the sense that we are not belonging directly to a university. We are really a research institute. We don't have direct teaching obligations, but we focus on research as much as possible. We were founded just after the Second World War with the idea to boost research in math and computer science in the Netherlands, in Amsterdam. So we are really on a nice site close to the city. And the mission is, it's about doing research in math and computer science, of course, but publishing it in leading journals, but also to bring it to society and to industry. So we try to make the link to practical applications as well. and a bit of the facts and figures. So around 200 people divided into 15 research groups. One of them, of course, is the group that I'm in, which is the scientific computing group. And all the ones are, well, about machine learning, multi-scale dynamics, computational imaging, stochastics, and then also the more, let's say, computer science oriented ones, like cryptography and security and things like that, cybersecurity. One of the things that we are very proud of is that Python was initially developed at our institute by Guido van Rossum back in the days as sort of a hobby project. And still we have several spin-off companies that result from PhD students typically, or staff that come up with bright ideas and they develop it into a company. So the scientific computing group, the group that I'm heading, I see it as combining three elements in all the work that we do. So that's machine learning, uncertainty quantification, and physics models. And what we want to do is predictive science. So often we have some physics model that is given by a differential equation. And in order to make it workable and be really predictive, we need to add uncertainty quantification methods to that. And then typically we use machine learning to speed up things. So in this way, this combination, is sort of our toolbox to address all kinds of problems, can be from different disciplines. And the main theme is that we try to design new UQ or new machine learning methods by using the knowledge that we have from the physics models. And this is also the concept of structure preserving that I will come back to later. And then there are different topics that already mentioned by Jungsu in the introduction. So closure models, that will be the topic of today's talk. Also reduced order models, which I will not talk about today, but we do a lot of work on that as well. Bayesian inference problems, and of course, neural networks. You cannot go around that nowadays. So let me continue with closure models, the topic for today. And they appear in a wide variety of applications. So the applications that we are typically interested in are coming from energy and climate problems. So for example, in the middle, you see wakes in an offshore wind farm, and one challenge is on how to design your wind farm and also how to control the turbines such that this wake influence is mitigated as much as possible. And of course, there's also questions about how to resolve clouds in climate models and weather models, which is typically too expensive, but it's very important. And also, this is a problem of sloshing of liquefied gas when it's transported in large tankers. So where does the closure problem come into play, and what is the closure problem? Well, in fluid flows, we typically have many scales of motion. So if you go back to this this wind farm case, then these scales are around 10 kilometer. If you zoom in to a typical wind turbine blade, then you encounter scales of maybe around a meter, and you already see you see some different types of scales in terms of the wake that is shed from the trailing edge of the blade. And then if you zoom on in further, then you actually see the turbulent boundary layer on the blade, and on the scale of maybe millimeters or even smaller. So simulating all these scales is definitely unfeasible with the computational model, and it will remain like this for many years. So the idea is to replace the very smallest scales with a so-called closure model. So the closure model has to approximate the effect that the small scales have on the large scales. So the idea is we only simulate this part, and the closure model takes into account the effect of the smaller scales on these larger scales. So it also occurs in other problems. For example, what I said, in climate problems. So you might have some hurricane in the Caribbean, and then that of course consists again of clouds. And if you want to know what's happening here, you don't want to resolve every single cloud because it's too expensive. And in this case, it's maybe not called closure modeling, but it's typically called parametrization. And also in other fields, the closure modeling problem is called sometimes coarse graining or similar. So it depends a bit on which field you work at, how it is called, but in fluid mechanics, it's typically called closure problems. Okay, so I start with one example of closure, and I use a very simple equation, namely Burger's equation, which is an advection diffusion type of equation. And indeed, in also this solution to this equation, is you get small scales if you have a small value for the viscosity parameter. The idea is now that you don't want to go to resolve all those small scales, but you want to already get a good solution on a coarse grid. And you could say, let's take a simple machine learning approach. And I'm trying to learn a neural network such that when I do time stepping, that it's going to give me a good solution on this coarse grid. So let's say the solution U, the next time step is just going to be given by sort of forward Euler time stepping with a trained neural network. You could do this. And in fact, when you look at the results, it doesn't look too bad. So in blue, there is the sort of the exact fine grid solution. And then in red, there's the trained neural network solution. So we train the neural network sort of offline, and then it's included in this time stepping to solve the solution. So it doesn't look too bad, but it's actually not hard to do better. So this is the idea of preserving structure. So in the previous example here, this equation where you say, can you see my pointer, by the way, if I move it?
Yeah,
okay. Here you didn't include any knowledge really about this PDE, right? So there's convection, there's diffusion, it's all in divergence form, so maybe time continuous. So these type of facts we could actually include when we want to learn the model. So first we have what we call the no closure model, in which we just solve the equation on a coarse grid. So we don't include any additional effects that should correct the solution. We call this the low resolution model, the no closure model, and we get an error of 0.1. Okay, I'm skipping the definition of the error, which is not so important for the point here. And then there's the basic machine learning model that I just showed before, and it's already a bit better, so that's nice. Then we can say, okay, let's do a bit more advanced. Let's take a neural ODE. So here we include a bit more structure, namely we assume that we have time continuity instead of the previous one. This was sort of time discrete, forward Euler time stepping. We assume it's time continuous, and we see we already benefit from that as the error drops by another factor two. And then we can take another step and say, hey, actually, if we do do write out the derivation of this this coarse grid model, it should be of this form. It should be the original equations containing convection and diffusion plus some correction term, which we call the closure model. And if you assume this form and you train the neural network for this, then again you find a drop in error. So we did not really do anything advanced with the neural network. We just learn different forms. We learn a different equation form. And then there's another step that you could take and say, hey, actually, we know that this equation is conserving momentum. So we write, we don't include the neural network directly, but we write the divergence of some neural network for a difference in this case. And then you see another small drop in the error. This is good news, right? So you can already, by just changing the way in which you formulate your equation and your neural network, you can reduce the error. And maybe an important point is that this is especially useful if you have small neural networks. And so that makes sense, of course, because with big neural networks, you can maybe learn anything. But for small neural networks, it pays off to include knowledge of the physics or the structure of your equation. Okay, so that's going to be the main part of today's talk, how to preserve structure in closure models and to attain stability. And then I will elaborate on what I just showed. And there's another part of the talk, and it depends a bit on how much time there is, but then I want to say a bit about how to train such models. And there are two different approaches, which we call derivative fitting and the other one trajectory fitting. And then the overarching three themes that I alluded to in the beginning, discretize first, preserve structure, and embedded learning will come back all the time during this talk. So that should become clear what that means. Okay, this is what I'm going to skip today. So you already know that. So that's for the future. So first a bit basics of closure modeling. So let's go back to the basics. So we consider PDEs that describe many skills. So it's a bit more of a mathematical setting now. So time evolution, PDEs, and then this F of U can, for example, be convection, diffusion, pressure gradient, like in Navier-Stokes. And they describe too many skills of motion when you have a small viscosity parameter. And in this case, so we have a single PDE that describes all the skills. So you also have multi-skill problems where you have multiple PDEs for different skills. But with Navier-Stokes, we just look at a single equation that describes all skills. And we try to reduce the range of skills by filtering. So we assume there's some filter, a kernel filter in this case with kernel G. And then we define this filter, the filtered velocity as applying this this filtering operation onto the velocity. And then when you filter your equation, then you come up with a PDE for the filtered quantities. That's the challenge, right? And what do you want? What do we want? Yeah, in the end, we want to have a coarser mesh and larger time set when we solve for the filtered velocity. So the art is to find the closure model that approximates the so-called commutator error. So the commutator error is the error that is that arises because the filtering operation and the PDE operator, they don't commute. And in particular, for Navier-Stokes, this will be due to the nonlinearity of the convective terms. So filtering and the nonlinear term, the quadratic term in Navier-Stokes equations, they do not commute. But you can have other sources of commutator errors, for example, due to boundary conditions or due to non-uniform filters. And so this closure model, so the idea is to develop a model just as a function of the filtered velocity, right? Because that is the thing that you want to solve for. And finding that is definitely an inverse problem, and it can have many multiple solutions. It can be ill-posed, etc. So this is a difficult thing, and you can actually think maybe this is impossible to do, right? You throw away a lot of information, all your small skills are thrown away, and you try to still you don't solve for the small skills, but you still try to understand what is the effect of the small skills onto the large skills. Well, we typically write it in this form. So the filtered velocity, filtered variable, the equation for the filtered variable is still written in terms of F of U bar. So it's the same F that we had before, but there's an additional term, and this is then the closure term, which is this. Yeah, approximate this commutator error. And in a picture, yeah, you could write it like this. So if we go to in a discrete setting, you would have a fine grid solution and you want to approximate it by a coarse grid plus some additional correction. It's not really very mathematically sound, but sometimes this conveys much more than all the equations. And traditionally, this closure model is formulated in a continuous setting. And then people use, for example, Smagorinsky model, the gradient model, etc. So that's a continuous expression for example, a turbulent viscosity, eddy viscosity, which is nice, but because of the interpretability, but it is rather difficult to have universal applicability. So the alternative route that we are looking at is to go to a discrete setting and use neural networks and make them tailor made to the problem. And this closure model, C as a function of U bar, is a complex nonlinear map, and closure models are definitely a good candidate for that. Neural networks are definitely a good candidate for that. Okay, so in pictures, it looks a bit like this. So we do have a PDE for all skills, which is on a continuous level. We filter that, so reduce the complexity, then we get the PDE just for the large skills plus a closure model. And then in the common approach is to follow this route. So first continuous and then you discretize. But what you could do instead, what we do is you say, okay, I first discretize all the skills. So I still have all skills in my system, large skills, small skills. So I get a semi-discrete system like this. The UDT is f of u, so this is now the discretized f. And then I reduce the complexity by doing filtering on the discrete system. And then I get a discrete closure model in addition on the right-hand side. Why would you want to do that? Well, the one thing is that you get consistency between the training data that's typically generated here and your prediction environment, which is over here. The inference problem that you still have to solve to get this closure model is in a sense easier on the discrete level. So you can think about the techniques as truncated singular value decompositions and so that the ways to regularize your inference problem, and that is easier on the discrete level. Also, the closure model is tailor-made to your discretization because you're already on the discrete level. And there are some other maybe more technical things related to regularity and to boundary conditions. So, and the other thing that we do, so besides discretize first, we try to preserve structure. So that's what I started with, the Burgers equation. So we can say, hey, we use an ODE formulation. Oh, sorry, this f of u should not be here. So the UDT is a neural network. And we can extend upon that closure model form. The UDT is the right-hand side plus the neural network. We can go further and assume it should be in conservative form. We can also say, okay, we want to have translation invariance because we know our PDE has this property, and use a convolutional neural network architecture, which has this translation property, translation invariance property. So this is what I already showed for Burgers to help these properties. And then an additional property that I want to talk about today is energy conservation, which is a great way to get stability. So if you just do the naive way in which you say, I add the neural network to my PDE and I train it, then we typically get into this model data inconsistency. Because you train the neural network offline, then you plug it into your PDE, and then surprise, you get instabilities. And that can be because your neural network goes outside of where it was trained during an actual time-dependent simulation, or it can be due to discretization issues. But this is a common issue, model data inconsistency and instabilities, when you use neural networks to represent your closure model. And there are a couple of approaches that have tried to tackle this, for example, by using artificial noise, by minimizing backscatter from small scales to large scales, by projection of the neural network onto a stable basis, like eddy viscosity basis, and recently also reinforcement learning. So it's a different way of looking at the problem instead of doing supervised learning using reinforcement learning. So our approach is slightly different because, as I said, we try to use energy conservation to guarantee stability. And so what is this idea? Well, many PDEs, including Navier-Stokes, they possess secondary conservation laws, like energy or entropy, and these give a stability bound. So if you look at Navier-Stokes, incompressible, so you have divergence of u zero, then momentum equation. And if you define your kinetic energy like this, then you can quickly derive that the change in kinetic energy for periodic boundary conditions is always negative. So kinetic energy is always decreasing in time, and it's due to viscous dissipation. So it's possible also to do this in a discrete setting, and then you get the discrete energy balance and a stability bound. And now our idea is to also use this type of structure for the filtered equations. That's not trivial, because if you filter, then you do not have this property anymore for the filtered quantities, right? So this holds for the original velocity field, but it doesn't hold for the filtered velocity field. So this is a challenge, and we'll come back to that later. I will not go to Navier-Stokes today, but I will show you the Korteweg-de Vries equation, which has some similar properties as Navier-Stokes. It's describes shallow water waves and has solitons as solutions, and it looks like this. So there's also a quadratic nonlinearity, and then there's a third order term, which causes dispersive waves. And it has the similar energy conservation property. So this is a secondary conservation law that you can derive by just multiplying this equation by U, integrating, and then then you get that the time derivative of this quantity, the energy, is zero. So here on the right you see some solutions, example solutions of the Burgers equations. And we discretize this system using a skew symmetric scheme, and then you get so this semi-discrete system, and you get the property, so this brackets are is an inner product. You get that also the discrete solution satisfies an energy equality. So that's what we see here. That's great. So far we didn't do any filtering yet, so that's going to be the next one. And what I said is we discretize first. So we have a discrete system already here that still describes all scales, small scales, large scales. And then we propose a spatial filter, which is just going to be a matrix, a matrix W. And it can be a filter that you like, a top hat filter or something else, but it's discrete already. And so we have basically two grids, the fine grid with all scales and the coarse grid with only the large scales. And W maps from the small scales to the large scales. Now, if you have this mapping W, this matrix, this filter W, you can also define a reconstruction operator, which does the other way around. So you reconstruct your solution at your coarse grid, at your fine grid, from the solution at your coarse grid. This is difficult to construct R because there are all kinds of choices you can make. But you can take, for example, one that simply prolongates the solution here to this point, and this point. And that's an example that we use. There are requirements on that, but I'm not going into detail here. But if you have a reconstruction operator R, then you can also define the subgrid scale content U dash as the difference of the original solution U and what you get when you reconstruct the filtered solution. So this is a definition. And how does that look like for this Korteweg de Vries equation? Well, you see indeed the solution in blue. You see the subgrid content in green, U prime, and then the reconstructed solution in red. And indeed, the subgrid scales are particularly important near the gradients. But so far, we didn't do anything yet. We just defined the filter and the reconstruction operator. Well, the good news is that with this particular combination of W and R, which satisfy this, we can decompose the energy in two parts. One part is the resolved scale energy, and the other one is the sort of the subgrid energy. And the good news is that there are no mixed terms in this expression. So there's nothing related to U bar and U prime. There's one just for the core scales and one term just for the fine scales. And that's because of this property. And then the time evolution of the total energy is just given by the time evolution of the core scale energy and the fine scale energy. And indeed, when you do when you look at your simulation, you see okay if you have a skew symmetric scheme, then indeed the total energy stays exactly constant, the blue line, and then the change in the coarse scale energy is exactly the negative of what happens to the fine scales. But if we want to use this type of energy stability, then we need information about the small scales. And when we solve only for the large scales, we only get U bar. So we don't know U dash. So if we want to use energy stability and we want to use this expression, we need to say something about U prime. And this picture also clearly shows that the large scale energy is not a conserved quantity, right? Only the total energy is a conserved quantity. Okay, so what do we do? Simulating U prime is not feasible. So instead, we replace it by a so-called compressed coarse grid variable S. And this S is chosen such that when you take an inner product, so when you look at the energy of S, it is approximately equal to the energy of the subgrid scales. And we get it by taking a linear compression. So we assume it is sort of a filter, but then different from W. this filter is called T, and we learn it from solving this problem. So we try to find this S such that its energy is as close as possible to the energy that was originally in the subgrid scales, in the small scales. And since this is a linear map, this really facilitates the rest of the analysis. So you can learn this S, and we did that. And here you see that instead of the green stuff that you saw before, which still had a lot of detail, right? Because it was the real subgrid variable. Here we just get blocks because we only it's at the same grid as the coarse grid solution. But still, the compressed variable identifies the sharp gradients. And of course, we can look at the energy, and we see that the learned compression matches the small scale energy very closely. So this indeed, the training was effective in the sense that we approximate the energy of the small scale well. Okay, now finally, we come to the real stuff. So what we are now going to do is maybe something special, because normally if you look at closure models, people typically look at the evolution of u bar of the resolved scales. So it's given by f of u bar plus some closure model. So we extend the system with the small scale dynamics, the compressed small scale dynamics. So this has the same dimension as this one instead of u prime, which is typically of much higher dimension. So the full closure model now consists of two parts. And the energy conserved in condition now in terms of the compressed variable is this one. Now we propose the following to model this closure model, this closure term, this one, by a skew symmetric matrix, which we call K, multiplied with the total solution vector U bar and S. So by taking a skew symmetric matrix for K, we automatically satisfy this condition, right? So if you multiply this entire system by U bar S transpose, so if you take the inner product of this thing, then the inner product with this part is identically going to be zero because this thing is skew symmetric. Okay, so some physical intuition behind this closure model form. So this is the matrix K, which consists of four parts. So there are two diagonal blocks and two off-diagonal blocks. The diagonal block K1 is basically an exchange of information or energy between the resolved scales. The blue one, all the diagonal block, is an exchange of information between the subgrid scales. And then the orange ones are energy exchange between the large and the small scales. So that is what we allow by taking a model of this form. So that is all I'm going to say about it, because the actual form of this K matrix is pretty involved, and I don't want to spend too much time on that. So I'm going to show some results of how this works. So here we do the Kortweg-de Vries equation, of course, and we use different initial conditions for training, and we test on unseen initial conditions. And we, in this case, we just do reduction from 600 points to 30 points. And we compare so that's a factor of 20, and we compare to a standard convolutional neural network as a closure model. So yeah, the solution, the reference solution in blue, looks a bit spiky, but that's because the grid is just basically very coarse. So you sort of miss the nice smooth solution that we saw before. But in fact, the skew symmetric neural network that we use for the closure model follows the solution really well. And a standard convolutional neural network as closure term, it's basically completely off. More interesting maybe is to look at the energy behavior. So the true solution is again in blue. That's a reference solution, which is the wiggly line here on the bottom. It's not energy conserving because the large scales only are not conserving energy. If you do not take a closure model, you get the purple line, and that is of course a straight line because that doesn't have a closure model in it, so it will still be energy conserving even though that's not what you want. this Q-symmetric one that we propose is really close to the reference solution, and a standard convolutional neural network as closure model has an increasing energy, and at some point this will basically diverge, lead to diverging solutions. What is also very interesting is to see the subgrid content. So this is something you would typically not get out of a normal closure model simulation, a normal simulation which you do not have an equation for the subgrid scales, because you would only know the resolved scales. But in this case, because we have extended our system with an equation for the subgrid energy, we also get it. So, and in effect, you see that this blue and this orange red blocks, they show that the reference subgrid energy and the skew symmetric solution are very much comparable. So we are actually solving the right thing. We also tested it to Burgers equation, because that involves viscosity. That's the equation I showed first during this presentation, and we included boundary conditions and so, and we did the reduction from n is 1000 to 40. And also in this case, we do see a very nice comparison between the reference solution and our skew symmetric neural network framework, also for the subgrid content. Okay, so this is a bit of the intermediate conclusion. So I looked now at two items, discretize first and preserve structure. Discretize first, as I mentioned, it helps in getting a stability analysis, but also in getting a training environment that matches the prediction environment. We added this subgrid scale compression, maybe the most important thing is that we designed the closure model such that it is energy conserving, and it's therefore stable by design. Let's see, there's, how much time do I have?
Well, 5 to 10 minutes.
Okay. So I want to see.
You can have, take as much as time you need.
Yeah.
Okay. We are pretty flexible, so.
I don't want people to all run away, but it would be nice to have some discussion. But I will say a bit about this. What about training, right? Because I didn't say anything about that, and also about architecture, but what about training neural closure models? I would say there are two distinct approaches that you could take. One is derivative fitting. So assume you have some signal, U as a function of time, you could say, okay, I have at some distinct points, I try to match the derivative. So the loss function would in that case look like this. So you try to find the parameters of a neural network such that the neural network matches the derivative. And if you have that, then you can march in time and you can do predictions. So this is very common to do, and it's relatively easy because you can do this completely offline, right? You generate your training data, and then you try to match your neural network solution to the derivative. You can also do trajectory fitting, as we call it. Some people call it embedded learning, or different words have been used for this. We call it trajectory fitting because instead of trying to fit the derivative, we try to fit the actual trajectory of the solver. So the loss function is now the reference solution that we have, for example, the blue one, and we try to match our solution to this reference solution. Of course, the solution U that we have is a solution to an actual differential equation with a neural network in it. So that means if you want to get derivatives of the loss function with respect to the parameters of the neural network, you need to know the derivative of the solution with respect to the neural network parameters. So you have to differentiate your complete ODE solver with respect to your neural network parameters. And that is much more involved, right? That's a much more difficult thing to do. But it's very interesting to see how these two methods compare, and not only in terms of accuracy, but also in terms of stability. So that is what we have looked at. There's a bit of theoretical sort of evidence or guidance that we use. And one is that for derivative fitting, we know actually that it can be inaccurate and unstable because of some old theorems from Heider, from Switzerland, already from the 90s in his book on solving ordinary differential equations. This is called the fundamental lemma in ordinary differential equations. And it's not about neural networks, but it's easy to change the theorem to hold for neural networks. So if you have a neural network that is close to the matches closely the time derivative to some epsilon, and it has some Lipschitz condition, then you get this error bound. And in the book of Heider, this is actually used as a positive thing in the sense that we have an error bound, but we actually look at it from the other side. If you are epsilon close with your neural network, you can still be very far away from your reference solution if you have a large Lipschitz constant when time progresses. So the fact that you approximate your derivative well doesn't mean that you get a good ODE solution. So that's the downside of derivative fitting. And then for trajectory fitting, the hope is that you get stable results, because it's tailor-made to the discretization. You force the trajectory in the right direction. But you need to compute these derivatives of the loss function, and that's typically done with sensitivity methods. So one option is discretize then optimize, and the other one is optimize then discretize. So if you do the first one, you need a differentiable ODE solver. If you do the other one, then you need to solve a set of adjoint equations. So we looked at both of these methods and we made a comparison. And here you see a bit of the pros and cons. So the derivative fitting is the one that I mentioned first. This is, I think, a common approach. If you do trajectory fitting, then if you do discretize and optimize, the big advantage is that your gradients become exact. Because you first discretize your system and then you compute the derivative with respect to the discrete system and you get the correct gradients. But if you first optimize and then you discretize and you solve the adjoint system, then that might be a different time integration method, etc. So you're not sure about having the correct gradients. But here in the discretized and optimized system, you need to have a differentiable ODE solver. So that's not something that everyone has. So, and then there are several issues, design choices that you need to make in the trajectory fitting approach. For example, how many time steps do you use in your loss function when looking forward? So what's your trajectory length? There are issues when you have stiffness in your equations. So if you use implicit solvers, then backpropagation might not be so easy. If you have chaotic systems, this is an additional complexity. There's always the issue of exploding or vanishing gradients also in this setting. So we have a test equation to investigate the different approaches, which is the Kuramoto-Sivashinsky equation, and it looks actually a bit like the Burgers equation, with the difference that the viscosity has a negative sign. So there's anti-diffusion, but there's hyper-diffusion to counteract that again. So it's a nice equation because it's both chaotic, so it's a deterministic equation, but chaotic solutions, and it is stiff, especially because of the fourth order term here. And in that case, because it's chaotic, we actually notice it doesn't really make sense to talk about the root mean square error or something like that, but we use the so-called valid prediction time and Lyapunov times to assess the accuracy. You need to make several choices on how you do the optimize then discretize or discretize then optimize. So we use different methods for that. That's important, but at the same time, and those are details. So here you see some solutions. This is two solutions that start initially very close and they diverge exponentially, or is what you expect for a chaotic system. And this is how it looks in space-time. So you get sort of pattern formations by solutions to this equation. And then we look at the case of optimize then discretize. So that is one option for the trajectory fitting. And we see that if we train on short trajectories, that the so-called valid prediction time in terms of Lyapunov times periods is larger than when we train on long trajectories. So here, all this color stuff is the error. So here the error is really big, and here it's still okay. So we have a longer time for which we can do good predictions if we have trained on short trajectories than when we trained on long trajectories, which is maybe a bit counterintuitive. And if you compare this optimized and discretized with the derivative fitting, we see it's only a slightly better. So yeah, it's maybe not what we had hoped for. But if you go to discretize then optimize, so in this case, the gradients are correct, as I said before, we get quite a bit higher valid prediction time. So especially for depending a bit again on what trajectory length is used, we can go to valid prediction times of about 7 Lyapunov time scales. And maybe the nicest graph to show the full comparison is this one. So here we look at the error as a function of time for all the different methods. So one is coarse ODE, which means there's no closure model. Then there's the derivative fitting one, which is the common approach, but as you see, it can be unstable. Then there's the adjoint ODE in different forms, which is the optimized then discretized. And there's the differentiable solver, which is the discretized then optimized. And so this trend is sort of telling the story. This one gives the overall best performance. The optimized then discretized is much more sensitive to the training interval and becomes less accurate for longer intervals. So let's keep it at that. This is the same, but with other numbers. So my conclusions for today is the three ingredients of the talk, as I said, so discretize first helps you to create tailor-made closure models. It's a useful framework when dealing with neural networks in your equations, and it eases the analysis. Preserving structure improves accuracy because we add physics knowledge, and it also makes it possible to get nonlinear stability by using the concept of energy conservation. And then the third ingredient, embedded learning by using trajectory fitting. We found that discretize then optimize is the best strategy to use if you have a differentiable solver. But there are many strings attached here, so it's highly problem dependent, and the comparison is not easy because the time integration methods that you use for the different strategies are typically different. So it's difficult to really compare apples to apples. This is a bit of the software that we have available. So we like to use Julia because it's a really nice framework to program differentiable codes, and especially there's this CIML package in which the differential equations.jl functionality is available. So we built onto that, and we now have also our Navier-Stokes code in Julia, and we are extending that with differentiable solvers as well. So that's going to be the next step to test the stuff that I showed today for these simple 1D equations to Navier-Stokes. I have a bit of advertisement. We have this option to do a postdoc, 1 year postdoc at our institute using this fellowship. So if you're interested, then let me know and you can apply using this link. Thank you very much for your attention. And let me know if there are questions.
Thank you so much for the wonderful talk, Benjamin. It was very interesting. Okay, let's have a Q&A session. Is there any question from audiences? I do not see any questions posted in the chat room. So I encourage you to do so or unmute yourself and then ask questions. Let me start by a few questions. Okay. For the training, I was about to ask that about the training, while I was hearing your first part of the talk, and at the end you actually showed how you actually trained the neural network, the closure neural network. I'm wondering about the cost. There's a different types of neural net training you're using, like the derivative matching neural net and the trajectory matching.
True. Net. Yeah.
And can you elaborate, compare the costs between those two. And also, because the solution process requires the training itself, that includes the training cost, I'm wondering, you know, if you compare the cost of the just the high resolution simulations versus the low resolution plus this neural closure, including the training cost, is still the low resolution plus neural closure model is faster than the high resolution, etc. So if you can elaborate on that.
Yeah, that's a very good point, because the derivative fitting is definitely much cheaper to train than the trajectory fitting, because you don't have to basically run the ODE solver backwards or whatever method you use. So derivative fitting is cheaper, and what we are trying is actually during the training is to mix. So for example, you could first do derivative fitting until you reach a certain convergence that you're happy with, and then use that as a starting point for trajectory fitting. So then you need less work in the trajectory fitting part of your solver, but in the end you're still doing that method, right? So it's sort of like a preconditioner, like preconditioning with derivative fitting when you do the trajectory fitting. So that that is one way in which you can alleviate the cost of the trajectory fitting. And the other thing is what is the additional cost of the neural network compared to just solving the equation mesh, right? Yeah, that's of course a valid question, and I think for the current one-dimensional problems, it is maybe better to just take a finer mesh. But in the end, when we go to 2D or 3D, I believe it will pay off.
I see. Have you done some floating operator comparison? Project, when we go to the complex, the 2D and 3D, the settings, indeed, this neural closure or ODE approach with the coarse resolutions will win the high resolution.
No, I haven't done that yet, and I'm also not confident yet about, because also depends on how big you make your neural networks, and I don't have a full there's no theoretical way to say for 1D, 2D, 3D I will need so many parameters, so this is still a lot of trial and error testing, hyperparameter tuning, all the stuff you encounter with neural networks,
right?
This is still ongoing. So I think what we try with this type of approach is we try to make it less dependent on the tip, the exact architecture or the exact hyperparameters, by adding more knowledge, adding more physics, and I hope that will also surface when we go to higher dimensions.
All right, sounds good. Okay, let me stop here, because we are getting a lot of questions in the chat room.
All right.
But before we go into the chat room, Harsh, you raise your hand. Do you want to unmute yourself and ask question if you have? Harsh? I see that you are muted, but I don't hear you.
Turn on the light, just a sec.
Okay. Unfortunately, we are not able to hear Harsh here. Okay, so let's move on. Okay, the first question in chat room is by Beiju. He asked, any intuitive explanation why training with long trajectory hurts?
Yeah, we do have some intuition for that. So one thing is that the solution, let's go to the slide. Yeah, so the solution at later times is much more sensitive to what happens to the parameters of the neural network because of the chaotic behavior of the system. So you can imagine that if you have a small change in, well, for example, initial condition, but also parameter, neural network parameters, that that will have a much bigger effect on what happens later during the simulation than initially. So this is the reason that for longer intervals you get more issues. Also, of course, the time integrator itself typically accumulate errors. So the error of the time integrator will also be larger at larger time intervals. So that's another effect. A third thing I think is that with if you use optimize then discretize, the gradients are not exact. So that also deteriorates. That becomes worse when you go to longer time intervals. Yeah. So that's some intuition.
Okay, great. Thank you. So next question is by Joan. Is the neural network closure model dependent on the discretization method? For example, finite difference, finite volume, finite element, etc.
Yeah. So indeed, in this case, then what we learned in the neural network closure model is, I would say, tailor-made to the discretization. So if you change the discretization, then you have to retrain. Of course, there's top probably some universality in it that we should try to deduce, but we didn't do that yet. Or maybe some sort of interpretability. But I see it now that you have a code that can solve your large-scale system, and you will, yeah, depending on which code you use, you will train your neural network specific to your code. That's how I see it now. And yeah. You could say, yeah, that's a pity. I'd rather have a Smagorinsky model that I can just implement in one line. But on the other hand, I think there's also good benefits on having something that is really matching your discretization and your code.
Got it. Okay. All right. Next question is by Albi. He asked, okay, great presentations. What difficulties do you expect in extending the algorithms to turbulent Navier-Stokes cases?
Yes, good question. I think it's difficult to say. So it depends. So the thing that I showed today is a compression still of maybe factor of 10 to 100. And I think if you want to go to Navier-Stokes, you want to go for more. And maybe in each direction, and that I'm not sure if that will scale. And of course, in Navier-Stokes, the small scales are really important in the sense that they dissipate energy. They determine how your spectrum looks like. And it might be that in the tests that we did so far, that the small scales are still relatively irrelevant. And that's a bit difficult to quantify yet. So we are looking now also at the energy spectra of the test that we did here, the 1D tests. But that's something that I can imagine that for turbulent Navier-Stokes is going to be more difficult.
I guess you need that coarse resolution you are using. It needs to be a little bit, finer resolution.
Sure.
Okay, so next question is by Tony. Thanks for the great talk. Any intuitive explanations on how the neural closure model on the resolved scales is related to the variational multiscale methods? Are you familiar with the variational
multiscale method? Yeah, it's a good question. And I have a colleague who does actually have some background in the variational multiscale method. And he came with a similar question, and I still have to check it. So. Yeah, I'm not sure. I think in the variational multiscale method, you're looking for you're looking for certain functions that you can integrate exactly because of there are some linear functions, and then you linearize if you cannot do that. We do not make such assumptions here, but I can still imagine that there are some links, but to be honest, I cannot fully answer that question. It would be cool to have a look at that.
Awesome. I know why Tony is asking that question, because I know he is expert in variational multiscale methods.
Okay. I hope I didn't say anything wrong.
All right. Okay, question by Harsh. Okay, great talk. In the conservative KDV equation, your approach outperforms standard CNN. How does it compare for the viscous example?
Okay, I didn't include that, but probably. Yeah, I would have to take our preprint. This case, I didn't show it, that's right. I don't know by on top of my head. So the.
But it's in the preprint?
Yeah, so well, the preprint is not out yet. It's still internal, but the PhD candidate who's doing the simulations, he has the results. And I didn't check for burgers yet. Maybe I'm too confident, but I think it will work.
Oh yeah, I see. Maybe you can get back to me, and then I can pass that to Harsh later.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, or I can connect you with the Harsh.
Yeah, there are a couple of things actually. I think I added it in my. So do you see my screen change now, right?
Mm-hmm.
So this is one of the things I didn't show, which is error convergence, for example.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, here you see that with the increase. So this basically indicates how much you compress. So how coarse is your grid. So if you have a very coarse grid, only 10 points, your error is still relatively large. But if you go with, so we are doing these tests, and we will also have them for burgers.
Mm. Yeah. Well, CNN is not even working for.
Yeah, for the coarsest grids, we didn't get stable results.
Okay. I see.
Yeah.
All right. I don't see any other the questions. It's a past 5 minutes. So I guess it's a time to wrap up here. Well, let's thank the Benjamin for the wonderful talk, and then interesting Q&A sessions. I'm sure the audiences, and including me, is got a lot of benefit from your talk. And also, I hope that with this talk, the future collaboration can be made, regarding this exciting research. So with that.
Thanks a lot. Yeah, I feel the same.
Benjamin.
Thanks for the nice questions also, by the way.
Yeah. If it was in person, probably there was a clap moment, but because
that's okay.
All right, sounds good. Okay, with that, let's end. Let me push the stop button for the recording.